Last time on Remaking Super Mario World in Godot, I didn't remake much of Super Mario World at all. So this time, let's populate this world with some blocks and enemies. I'm gonna break down how they work on the SNES and how I'm making them work in Godot. Hi there, I'm Y, and to teach myself game development, I'm remaking Super Mario World in the Godot engine. In the last video, I did a more or less deep dive into player physics, and I left off with the basic Mario moving around. And it's about time I give him something to move towards. In this video, I want to figure out how to make question blocks, turn blocks, coins, and also an enemy or two. And unlike last time, this is going to take some more planning and use some interesting Godot features. So let's jump right at it. First, let's look at blocks. Super Mario World has turn blocks that Mario can hit to make them spin, question blocks that have stuff inside them, and a lot more. When Mario hits a block, it bounces up for a bit, and then it can change into another block. But before I get to making these blocks in Godot, let's look at how they work on the SNES. And for that, we need to know the difference between background and foreground layers and sprite tiles. The SNES has two ways to display graphics on the screen. Number one, background and foreground layers. These layers are made of tiles arranged in a grid. In other words, a tile map. The tile map can move as a whole, but the individual tiles are fixed to the grid. You can have up to four of these layers, and the SNES doesn't care if they're used for backgrounds or foregrounds, that's for the game to decide. Super Mario World mostly uses one layer for the level's foreground, another for the background, and a third layer for the status bar, the title screen border, and additional background effects. Number two, sprite tiles. Sprite tiles can move independently of the background and foreground layers and independently from each other. The downside is that, because of SNES limitations, you can't have too many at a time. In Super Mario World, Mario, all the enemies, and all the small graphical effects are drawn using sprite tiles. If you want a much more competent and in-depth explanation, check out the fantastic video series from Retro Game Mechanics Explained. By the way, these terms can get really confusing. For example, in Godot, a sprite is just the general name for the graphics of anything. We are dealing with three different worlds at the same time, where basic terms mean completely different things. And if I'm being inconsistent with them sometimes, hopefully the meaning will be clear enough from the context. So now that we have this background info, and foreground info and sprite info, how do blocks work? In Super Mario World, all these blocks are on the foreground layer, and they're part of the level tile map, just like the ground and the pipes, for example. But the thing you see when you hit a block is actually a sprite tile. If it weren't, it would be stuck to the grid. The game temporarily removes the block and draws a sprite tile there instead. The blocks can't be made from only foreground tiles, because then they couldn't bounce, and they can't be made from only sprite tiles, because there's a limit on how many you can have at a time. So the game takes this hybrid approach. Now, with these building blocks in mind, let's get to building blocks in Godot. I could make blocks the exact same way as the original game. Make them tiles in the foreground tile map, and have them spawn some kind of separate graphic when Mario hits them. And the first part is easy. I can add some block graphics to the tile set, make a new tile from it, and then place it in the level. And there we have our first block. But then, how would I make it do something when Mario hits it? Tile maps in Godot only control appearance and collision, not behavior. You can't easily say, if I touch this tile, perform this action. So a tile map doesn't seem like the right tool for the job after all. But that's okay. I can just implement blocks as their own scenes, just like the player character, with a hitbox and the graphic and all that. Not only is that possible in Godot, but I'm pretty sure it's the recommended way too. So I'm gonna create this block scene with a static body 2D node as a base, and give it a collision shape and an animated sprite. To make blocks bounce, I need velocity and gravity, and static bodies don't have those built in. But I can add them to the script myself. In Super Mario World, the initial bounce speed is hex 40, that's 64 subpixels per frame, and it even has its own gravity value. I'm gonna write a bounce function that gives the block some initial vertical speed, and then in the process function, I'm calculating the position based on speed and speed based on gravity. I'm gonna add a timer node, make it run for 8 frames, just like the original game, and when it runs out, I'll snap back the position and speed. For testing purposes, I'm just gonna make the block bounce whenever I press the down button. Well, look at that, I am making Flappy Bird after all. So now it just needs to bounce when Mario hits it. Turns out you can't really use collision shapes to detect which two things are colliding. Looks like I need an area 2D node for that. So I'm adding them to both the block and to Mario's head. That shape is just temporary, I'll come back to it. And to detect when Mario hits the block, that's where signals come in. A signal is a way that a node can communicate to other nodes further up in the tree that something has happened to it. For example, the Area 2D node has this Area Entered signal that fires when it touches another area, and I can connect that signal to a function in the block script. So now that function is gonna run every time Mario hits the block. And I should probably make sure it only bounces once. And actually, I might as well only change the position of the animated sprite and keep the block itself stationary. And there we go! All the blocks you could ever want. Unless you want some other types of blocks. Now that I have question blocks, I could just repeat the process for turn blocks, make a new scene with all the same nodes. Then they would be completely separate from each other. And what if I wanted to make a change to both of them? I need a way to have all blocks related to each other. And that way is called inheritance. It's when you define some base object and other objects can share its properties and define their own on top of it. This is very common in programming, where you can inherit variables and functions from classes. But in Godot, you can also inherit nodes from scenes. That's called an inherited scene, and it seems to be just what I need. With inherited scenes, I can build my own hierarchy of block types, starting with the general and building up to the specific. A block has a collision shape, a sprite, and an area for hit detection. A hittable block is a block, so it has all that, plus a bounce sprite and a bounce timer. A question block is a hittable block, so it has all that, except its sprites look different. A turn block is also a hittable block, except its sprite looks different, and it has some extra code that sets it to spinning mode when Mario hits it. And finally, a used block is just a block. It's not hittable. It only has a different sprite. And that way, if I want to change the bounce speed, for example, I just have to do it for the hittable block scene, and all the blocks that inherit from it will also change automatically. Yep, that worked out pretty nicely. Fun fact, Super Mario World uses 4 memory addresses to keep track of which turn blocks are spinning, so only 4 of them can be active at a time. But I'm not gonna replicate that. Now, the only thing that's bugging me is, all these blocks are taking up a lot of space in the scene list. This is when I learned about another Godot feature. A tile map isn't just for tiles, you can put any scene you want in there. I'm gonna add the blocks to the list of placeable things, a scene collection, and now I can place them as if they were tiles. That doesn't mean they're fixed to the tile grid, just that their placement is managed by the tile map. And they don't clutter up the scene tree anymore. That feels like the best of both worlds. Now, as much as I'd like to be done with blocks, this square hitbox was only ever a placeholder. What should it really be? It's time to look into block interaction. This square hitbox does look off in some places. Maybe I could just make it more narrow? But in the original game, hitboxes are actually much more complicated than that. To interact with foreground tiles, Mario has 8 so-called interaction points. 1 in the middle, 1 on his head, 4 on the sides, and 2 on his feet. The game constantly checks which tiles are underneath each point, and from there it can run different code depending on which point is on which tile. For example, when the head point is on a question block, the block bounces. To save the SNES some effort, some of these points are skipped sometimes. For example, when Mario is on the right half of a tile, the 2 points on the left are ignored. The block interaction code from the original game is really convoluted, and I didn't go through it in great detail, but that's basically how it works. The hitbox not being a square also helps avoid things like this, where Mario doesn't seem to be touching the corner, but the hitbox is. So in Godot, I just make the hitbox these 8 points, right? Well, if only it were that simple. The side points are sticking out, so Mario can get snagged on the side of blocks. And that's when I realized there's a difference between collision and interaction. In Super Mario World, collision and interaction are pretty much the same thing. Solid tiles make Mario stop moving, and they push him away to keep him from getting snagged, and that's basically part of their interaction code. That's what these blocks are programmed to do. But in Godot, as far as I know, the two are very different. Collisions are all handled by the physics engine through collision objects, and interaction is something I can define myself through areas. If I wanted to use the interaction points for collision too, I would have to somehow code the push Mario away part into every solid object. But at that point I might as well code my own collisions from scratch. And that doesn't seem very in line with my goal to learn Godot. I do want this project to be accurate, but I want to do it with Godot, not against it. So after a lot of experimenting, I'm going with this. For interaction, I have this area 2D with the same interaction points as the original game. Now every block can detect which of these points it's touching, and then run different functions. So now the question block can only be hit from one side. And for collision, I'm mostly using something called separation rays. If they collide with something, they push Mario outwards until they don't collide anymore, which is exactly what I want. That also replicates another feature of the original game, where one-way platforms can push Mario to the top if he's close enough. In the end, all this collision stuff is probably not pixel perfect, but it feels pretty good. Now, after all this hard work on blocks, I think I'm gonna reward myself with some coins. Coins are actually pretty straightforward, because they're just another type of block. I'm just gonna disable their collision, change their graphics, and make them erase themselves when they touch any of Mario's interaction points. But how do I actually increase the coin counter? On the SNES, everything is basically a global variable. There are no objects or scopes, you just work directly with memory addresses. But in Godot, this one coin doesn't know about the state of the whole game. So where do I store the coin count? I'm gonna use an autoload, which is a script that you can access from anywhere. That way, any object can give Mario a coin, and any object can read out the number of coins, like this placeholder label. I'll make a proper status bar sometime later. I'm not actually sure if an autoload is the best way to go, because you generally want to avoid having too many global variables, but it does the job. Another fun fact, in Super Mario World, the coin counter has a queue built into it. If Mario collects multiple coins at the same time, the coins only count up once per frame, until the queue is empty. That's easy to replicate, so I'm just gonna do that. And of course, coins can also come from question blocks. So I'm gonna add a variable to the hittable block scene that spawns when Mario hits the block. I can make a simple spinning coin scene, put it in there, and there we go. Or I could use any other scene I have lying around. Now that coins are done, I think it's time to add some more moving objects. Because you know what they say, once you make money, you make enemies. In Super Mario World, pretty much anything that moves and interacts with Mario falls into this category, from platforms to Paracoopas to P-switches. In ROM hacking, we call them sprites, and that doesn't just mean the graphics, but also the entire code and behavior. But that word is already confusing enough, so for this series, I'm just gonna call them entities. Or enemies if they can hurt Mario. On the SNES, entities are responsible for their own graphics. Their code draws sprite tiles to the screen one at a time. It can get pretty complex when you need to draw and animate multiple tiles. And, in order not to trouble the SNES too much, the game only lets you have 12 of these at a time. Most entities only spawn when they're about to be in view, and then despawn when they're far enough away. In Godot, This is a lot easier. All I need to do is make an entity scene. Instead of coding the graphics one tile at a time, I can just add a Sprite 2D node. And instead of only having 12 at a time, I can have as many as I want. Though I do need to implement spawning and despawning, otherwise they would all start walking from their starting spot way before they're supposed to. I can use a visibility notifier for that, and only run the process function when that area is visible on screen. And I can build a hierarchy of inherited scenes, just like I did with blocks. There's a basic entity scene that defines things like hitboxes and whether it despawns, an enemy class with extra functions for things like hurting Mario, and from there I can make all the individual enemies. For collision and for interaction with tiles, entities have interaction points, just like Mario does. So I'm remaking those in Godot the same way I did before. They're gonna come in handy for things like making shells able to hit blocks. But for interaction with other entities, and with Mario, they actually just have a rectangular shape. Finally something working the way you'd expect. So now, both Mario and his enemies have three kinds of hitboxes. One for Godot's physics engine, one for interactions with blocks, and one for interactions with each other. Now I can check if Mario's hitbox is touching the enemy's hitbox. If he's on top, he kills the enemy, unless it's an invincible one. And if he's not, he gets hurt instead. Which for now is just me printing out a line of text, but I don't think Mario's complaining about that. This Rex is just one enemy of many I'll have to make eventually. But once you've got the basic template, which I do now, that should be pretty quick. This feels like a good amount of progress for this video. But before I go, I thought I'd respond to a couple of comments I got on the first one. Number 1, why not use Godot's physics process function for Mario? I actually am. Physics process runs at a fixed rate. So yeah, I don't actually need to do all the delta calculations myself. But it's still good to be aware of these things. And I like keeping the units consistent across the project. Number 2, why not use a state machine for Mario's physics? I'm a big fan of state machines, and for those of you who are not, that can only mean you don't know what they are yet. A state machine is a structure that has states and defines transitions between those states. It helps you simplify and organize your code. It runs one state at a time, and in each state, the code is responsible only for what to do in this state and when to change to another state. Super Mario World uses state machines a lot, from enemy behavior to the whole underlying game loop. And they came in really handy for the attack patterns in the boss fights I've made. But for Mario's physics, the behavior is really interconnected, and I'm not sure how exactly to split it up, and if that would even help. Maybe I'll come back to it. Number 3, will the code be released? Yeah, when the project is done, I'm gonna release the source code so anyone can tinker with it. And I should probably clarify, it's not my goal to bring a full port of the game to the market, or to make a general-purpose kind of platformer template, or even to remake 100% of the game, even though others are welcome to do that. I just decided to remake a game that already exists because it gives me a clear goal to work towards, and I chose Super Mario World because it's familiar to me. I will be putting the code out there, but not as something I'll be maintaining forever, just as a little personal project that I'm happy to share. And yeah, this is where I'll leave it for this video. I've populated the level a bit, and I've learned a lot. For the next video, I want to tie up all the loose ends I'm leaving, make more types of blocks and enemies, a real status bar, and also power-ups and pipes, so this first level will be more or less finished. Let's see how much longer I can put off making cape physics. So thank you so much for watching. If you enjoyed this video, you're still a frickin' nerd.